Alright, so as I was also here, I am just going to start by reviewing the definitions of VIH and VIL before we move on to the other characteristics of the CMOS inverter. So what we said was we wanted to, the overall VTC, the voltage transfer characteristics, looks something like this, right? This point is VDD, this is also VDD, and here we have 0. Okay. So in other words, how does this behave? When the input is 0, the output is VDD, when the input is VDD, the output is 0. At some point in between, Vout will be equal to Vin. That point we define as Vm, the midpoint voltage. Okay. And apart from that, we also want to find out some level at which I can clearly say, okay, this is no longer an input low. From here onwards, I cannot treat this as input low. Can I treat it as input high? I don't know. There might be some stage in between where I can say neither input low nor input high. I really don't know what to say about this. But anything below this voltage is input low. Anything above this voltage is input high. Okay? So typically, if you just and if I just ask you from this graph, what would you consider as an input low voltage? What would you say? How would you go about deciding that? What is your idea of input low? What should be the property of input low? Huh? The output should be high, right? Something can be considered as an input low if the output is high. So this sounds like a slightly circular definition, but that's the best that we can do really. Okay, so what we want is something where we can clearly say, okay, you know, this input is low because the corresponding output is high. How do I know whether the output is high? I also have a definition of what is output high. Okay, now in this particular case, what you are saying is, if I just ask you to mark on this, saying, okay, this point of input low, would you say that this voltage should be the VIL? After all, what I am saying about VIL is, it is the maximum voltage which can be considered as a input low. So this voltage leads to this output. Is it a good value for VIL? It's okay, there's no problem with that because everything below this voltage is definitely low. But there are some values above this voltage also which look like they might be low. Right? What about this point instead? If I tell you that this point is VIL, this is clearly not right. Okay, because for this value of input, the output definitely does not look high. Okay. The third possibility is whether to take Vm itself as VIL. This is definitely better than the other two, because one thing I can say for sure, any VIL, any VI is above this, and the output is going to be below this value. Okay. But on the other hand, this is also not satisfactory because Vm, VDD by 2 is not an input, is not an output high by any stretch of the imagination. Right? I don't know whether it's output high or output low, but I definitely can't say for sure that this is output high or output low. Okay. So because of this confusion, what we say is we need some better way of defining what is the input high and the input low. We are going to sort of define it by saying that for any change in the Vn, what happens to the corresponding Vout? Okay? If there is a small perturbation in Vn, will the corresponding Vout be larger than that perturbation or smaller than that perturbation? Okay? Now, what is that determined by? respect. So ultimately what you are interested in is what is the delta VO for a given delta VI. And as we take the limit for very small values of delta VI, we know that that's the derivative. Okay. So d by dVI of dV of VO is ultimately something which can help us to decide whether or not a change in input will lead to a larger or smaller change in the output. Okay. And what we say is, I want this to be small. For a given change in input, I want the output change to be small. How small? Smaller than the change in input. Okay. So what we say is, if as long as this quantity is less than 1, it means that for a given change in VI, output change will be smaller. Okay. So based on that, we say, okay, now I will look for the point where dVO by dVI is equal to 1. Magnitude. I know that dVO by dVI is negative, so I am actually effectively looking for the point where dVO by dVI is equal to minus 1. Right? I have two such points on this graph. One of them is here. The other one is here. Okay. In between those two points, there is some. So I can now find out a VI corresponding to that, to each of those points. Okay. And in between them, I have some blank area, which I'm going to say unknown. This is neither low nor high input. Okay. And that is how I am defining effectively what is the largest input low voltage and also the smallest input high voltage. Okay. Everything else around it. So the output low and output high are clear from the graph. I just look for what is the output high corresponding to input of 0, that is the best output high, and the output low corresponding to input of VDD, that is the best possible output low. VOH and VOL I can straight away read off from the graph. Right? This point and this point. But VIH and VIL are a slightly more tricky definition. Essentially, the thinking behind it is to say I want to have some VIL and VIH such that any increase in input beyond this, on the case of VIL, will cause a larger change in the output. Okay? Or vice versa, in the case of VIH, if I decrease the voltage from there, then there will be a larger change in the input. Okay? And anything in between those two values, VIL and VIH, I basically declare it to be unknown. I don't know whether this is high or low. Okay. So because of that, any input which is lying in that entire range, VIL to 0 or VIL to VOL, is a valid 0. And any input which is lying in the range, VIH to VOH, right, is a valid 1 at the input. It will lead to a proper value at the output. Okay? You might ask the question, why am I even bothering with VOH and VOL? For a CMOS inverter, VOH is equal to VDD, VOL is equal to 0. That's very clear. But there are other inverters. For example, a resistive load NMOS inverter, right, which you'll probably look at in one of the assignments or something, where VOL, for example, will not be 0. Right, the output low voltage, even when the input goes to maximum, the output will not go to 0. It will go somewhere close to 0, but not exactly to 0. Okay, so that's why you need VOH and VOL. Right? You can still read it off from the graph, but it has to be defined because there is a possibility that the output can never actually go all the way to zero. Okay? Alright, so is this clear? This is a better explanation for us. Alright. So, now that we have qualitatively looked at what the CMOS inverter characteristics look like, let's see if we can write down some of the current equations and get some better estimates for some of the parameters. Right? The first one that we are interested in is VM, the midpoint voltage. How do we estimate this? Okay, how do we actually get the value for the VM? That's actually very easy. From the graph, all I need to do is draw one line VO equal to VI. Wherever that intersects with the VTC, that point is VM. That's my midpoint voltage. Okay. Now, can I sort of form an estimate of what is the value of VM without bothering to actually do the computation? Without just empirically drawing some lines on a graph, can I compute this or can I estimate it? That's the question. Huh? So how would you do it? Equate the current, right? So what does the inverter schematic look like? I have a PMOS transistor and an NMOS transistor. Okay. Input is VI, output is VO. Supply is VDD, the other source terminal of NMOS is at ground. Okay. Assumption is that the bulk terminal of NMOS is at ground. Bulk terminal of PMOS is at VDD. Bulk terminal of PMOS must be at VDD. It has to be at the highest possible potential. Right? To prevent any other forward biasing of junction. Okay, now if I set VO equal to VI on this, I can actually I can see that the VGS and VDS of both the transistors are now different in terms of the VO or VI, whatever, VM basically. Right? And remember what I said, this is a static characteristic. Right? Which means that if I apply that voltage VM and just keep it over there, the output is going to remain at VM. Okay, it's not abruptly changing, it's not switching at that point. I have slowly increased the voltage until it reaches the point VM. The output will drop to that same value VM and it will hold steady at that point. There is not going to be any trying to switch to one side or the other. This is perfectly static and valid. Right? But under these conditions, as we saw in the last class, this basically corresponds to this region of operation. What region of operation are the two transistors in? Both can be, most likely are going to be in velocity saturation. They might be in saturation also, but they are definitely not cut off and almost certainly not in the linear region. So it's a question whether it is either just plain saturation or velocity saturation. Okay, that's the only confusion which is there. Okay. So, let's do one thing, let's try and estimate what will be the VM value based on this information. What I'm going to do is, I'll first write this out for the case of a long channel transistor because the equations are slightly simpler over there. Okay, and then we'll also briefly look at what it looks like for a short channel transistor. What's the difference? Velocity saturation. Long channel transistor will not have velocity saturation, right? Because the electric field, the maximum electric field that forms over there is not high enough to make the velocity of the electrons so high that they physically saturate. Okay, so the general idea is long channel transistors will not get velocity saturated. Short channel transistors will easily get velocity saturated. Okay? Which means that as far as the long channel transistor is concerned, that midpoint operating voltage, the region of operation for both the transistors is what? What region of operation is it? Saturation, not velocity saturation. Okay. So now, remember what I said about this being static. Whatever current is flowing through this must also flow through this. The same magnitude of current must flow. That's just such a current law, right? Because there's no load connected over here, no resistive load, so nowhere else for the current to flow. Okay? Even in practice, typically what will happen is one inverter like this will probably be connected to the gate terminal of another gate, right? The input terminal of some other gate, which essentially is the gate terminal of some other transistor, which means it is an insulator. No current can flow into that. Okay. So under static conditions, always the current that flows through the PMOS of this thing must naturally flow through the NMOS. Okay. That's just the Kirchhoff's current law. So with that in place, how much is that current? Let's write out the equation. The current through the NMOS is mu n C of W n by L n, right? What VGS of the NMOS? VI, which is the same as VO, which is VN. So I'm straight away going to write VM over here. Okay, I'm using the subscript N everywhere just to make things clear. So WN, LN, VTN, μN, etc. COX does not really depend on whether it's N or P type. COX is just another process which is growing the gate oxide. So it does not depend on N or P. So I don't bother putting the subscript over there. Now this must be equal to what? The current through the PMOS, which is given by, once again remember I am only writing out magnitudes over here. In reality you will have to take the sign into consideration for all of these things. I mean, either you take the sign into consideration or you clearly write out the magnitudes alone and make sure that you are equating them correctly. Right? In this case what I am saying is, what I am now going to write on the right hand side is only the magnitude of the current. And the current itself, the direction of the current is downward. Okay? It is from the source to the drain of the PMOS transistor. Therefore, it is equal to the drain to source current of the NMOS transistor, not minus of that. Okay? What is the VGS? The magnitude of VGS for the PMOS transistor is VDD minus VI, right? Or VDD minus VN. Okay? Now I am going to do one thing. I will define this parameter R as the ratio of mu t C of W t by L t mu n C of W n by L n. I'm just introducing some new parameter out there. Okay, this is R. So what happens? Now I can write out the same equation. I'll take square root on both sides and collect the terms together. Okay? So we have a clean expression that we have got for Vn. Oh yeah, sorry. Let me simplify things and define R as root of 2. Okay? Because it doesn't really do anything useful for us otherwise. So this is R square into 2. Okay? So, alright. So now everything is defined in terms of this parameter R. Right? What can we say about Vn? What is the value of Vn going to be? It obviously is a function of R. Right? So what value of R should I choose? What is the ideal value of Vn that I want? VDD by 2. Okay? What R should I choose so that I get VDD by 2? R equal to 1 is probably my best bet. What happens when R is equal to 1? Now, VTP and VTN, both magnitudes. By the way, the threshold voltage, this is not something that I had discussed earlier, but again, this is something which comes from the VLSI technology course or technology aspects of it. The threshold voltage is something which is, to a large extent, under the process designer's control, not the circuit designer. As a circuit designer, you have to work with a given threshold voltage. You will just be told, okay, this is the threshold voltage, use it for your calculation, right? But the process engineer can play around with the threshold voltage. It is possible to change the threshold voltage slightly. One of the ways by which this can be done is, after all, this is a capacitance that we are talking about, right? The MOS transistor, the gate terminal, acts like a capacitance. And what we are saying is only when the voltage goes above a certain threshold, that is to say only when it goes above a certain point, that capacitance is such that charge starts building up and the channel forms over there. So now how do you control how much charge builds up? You can deposit some fixed charges over there at that interface. Okay? So there are procedures known as ion implantation and so on, where you can directly go in and mess around with that interface between the oxide and the bulk substrate and change how much is going to be the threshold voltage of the transistor. Okay? Because of that, it means that to some extent at least, the process engineer can change the threshold voltage. There are other parameters like the work functions and the built-in potentials and so on which also control this threshold voltage. But at least some part of it can be controlled by the process engineer. Okay? And because of that, usually what people do is they try and make the PMOS and NMOS threshold voltages as close to each other as possible in magnitude. Okay? Now, if I do that, what will happen to this? When R is equal to 1, I get VTP is equal to VTN. So this will approximately become equal to VDD by 2. Approximately because VTP and VTN may not be exactly equal. Okay? So midpoint voltage, Vm equal to VDD by 2. For getting that, what did we have to choose? R equal to 1. Okay? What is R? R is square root of mu p W p by L p mu n W n by L n. Okay? Once again, L p and L n over here are pretty much going to be equal. They are always going to be minimum width, minimum length. Okay? So in other words, what we are saying is or the parameter WP by WN is equal to mu N by mu P. This value is approximately around 2 or so for our process. What I mean by our process is, we are considering throughout this course some process conditions under which we are designing these gates. Right? For that process, we are going to assume that mu n is approximately twice of mu 2. We know that mu n is greater than mu 2. We know that in general mu n is around 2 to 3 times of mu 3. For this particular process, we will assume 2. Why? Mostly because it simplifies our calculation, not because it's accurate. Okay? It makes the calculation from here onwards much easier, so I am going to assume mu n by mu 2 is equal to 2. Okay? So Wp by Wn must be equal to 2. Right? This is, remember, this is the only parameter which is under the designer's control. Everything else, mu p, mu n, t of vt, n vtt, all of those things are to some extent under the process engineer's control, to some extent under nobody's control, just plain physics. Okay? But Wp and Wn are definitely something that you as a designer can choose. So what is this equation telling you? If you want the midpoint voltage to be as close as possible to VDD by 2, choose the ratio of the sizes of the transistors to be equal to 2. Right? To be more accurate, to be equal to mu n by mu t. Okay? Now, okay. So, next thing that we can consider over here is, let's consider what happens if one of the transistors is stronger than the other. What do I mean by a stronger transistor? In the context of this course, a transistor is strong if it can deliver more current. What can you do to make a transistor stronger? Make it wider, increase W. Okay? So in general in this course, when I talk about strong transistors, it means wider transistors. Weak transistors, narrow, W is less. Okay? I can also make L more, but in general I don't mess around with the L. Okay? Always minimum length. So in that case only the W is going to be played around with for getting wider or narrower transistors. That is stronger or weaker transistors. So now let's just quickly look at what happens if I make the PMOS stronger. Yeah. Okay, so the question is, is there a reason under which Vm not equal to VDD by 2 may be desirable? Is that your question? Okay, so good question. Why is it a problem if Vm is not equal to VDD by 2? In general, it's not a problem. The main reason is the noise margin. Okay? By having Vm equal to VDD by 2, you have made your transfer characteristic at least symmetric. So now what that means is, how much deviation can you allow on the low side before it flips over and starts treating as a high input? Or else how much can you allow on the high side before it flips over and starts treating as a low? Right? Those are equal. So, given that you don't have any other sort of guiding condition for building an inverter, this is the preferred one. Balance it. Make sure that the two sides are equally balanced. Right? But that's pretty much the only reason why you want to have it balanced. That's it. Noise margin is the strongest reason for having a symmetric inverter. There are also some things like the Vm equal to VDD by 2 may also have some effect later on the rising and falling delay. But that's a slightly different matter. That is also affected by other things. Right? So it may not be exactly the same as, in fact, the condition for the same rising and falling delays may not be the same as the condition for the Vm equal to VDD by 2. Right? So Vm equal to VDD by 2 is just a choice that you make given that there are no other sort of guiding conditions. You want it to be symmetric, you want the noise margins to be equal, to be as high as possible on both sides. That's the only thing. Okay? Having said that, there are conditions where you might want it to be asymmetric. Right? You might want to have something which has a high threshold of switching. Okay? One possibility is, let's say that you are dealing with some kind of a noisy input signal which you want to clean up, and for some reason, based on the physical characteristics, you know that the noise is such that it affects the low values more than the high values. Okay? I'm just making this up. I can't give you an actual example where this happens, but there could be a situation where you want to essentially get some signal from outside and you want to convert it into a clean digital signal. You know that the amount of noise close to ground is higher than the amount of noise close to VDD, or vice versa. What would you like to do with the inverter which takes in such an input in the first place? Make the noise margin on the low side higher. Okay? Which means you want to shift that VM higher. Can you do that? How would you do it? Change WP by WM, right? So now let's also look at the same expression for VM in terms of R and see what happens if I want to increase VM above VDD by 2. Right? Should I increase the value of R or decrease the value of R? Not very clear from this equation, because there is an R by 1 plus R and also one minus R term somewhere in the numerator. Okay? So let's instead think about this intuitively. Right? At the end of the day, the right way to do it is the calculation. Right? You actually do the calculation, you do a simulation and you find out whether or not you have actually managed to increase your VM. Right? That's the only correct way of doing it. But as an estimate, we can sort of see, is there any way by which I can sort of tweak this characteristic? Okay, what I have is, this, right, VDD by 2. What are the two transistors which I have? I have a PMOS and an NMOS. Okay? What happens if I make the PMOS stronger? Qualitatively, just intuitively, what will happen to the PMOS when it is stronger? Let's look at what is happening somewhere here, right? Close to this point where it starts dipping. Right? What is happening now that NMOS has turned on? So it's able to sink some current. The PMOS is already on, it is in saturation. Sorry, it's in the linear region. Right? So current can flow through both of them. Okay? I got this characteristic by considering some current flowing through both of them. Now what I am saying is the PMOS has become stronger. Let's say instead of WT equal to 8 lambda, which is what I got from the VDD by 2, I make it 10 lambda or 12 lambda. Okay? What happens under that condition? For the same amount of current to flow, the PMOS is going to deliver that current more easily. Okay? So the NMOS is going to be fighting harder against the PMOS to bring that voltage down. Right? When do I need a high voltage across the PMOS VDS? Only when that high voltage is required for a certain amount of current. But if the width is higher, right, then I don't really need to worry with a higher voltage. So what happens when the PMOS is stronger is, automatically it starts shifting to the right. For a given voltage, the PMOS is able to deliver a larger current than the NMOS sensing. Okay? So the NMOS, in order to take the same amount of current, needs a larger value of VDS across it. So it has shifted to the right. And correspondingly, what is the NMOS first corner? It means that the moment that I go above threshold, the NMOS immediately starts changing a larger amount of current. Which means that the voltage drop across the PMOS for sustaining the same amount of current must be larger. So the VDS, that is the VDD minus VO on the PMOS must be larger. So it starts dropping away early. Okay. What do I mean by a strong NMOS? Mu n is large. Sorry, mu n and mu t cannot be changed. So W n must be larger. Right? In this case, what it's telling you finally is that R must be made smaller for making the NMOS for making the PMOS stronger. Okay? Because R is R is WP by WN. So, to make the PMOS stronger, WP must go up, R must go up. Right? And intuitively at least, you can see that this is what will happen. You can also plug in the values and see how it actually varies. Right? The variation will not be too much. In general, what you will find is that the amount of variation from VDD by 2 is not very large. Okay, you need to go to really large PMOS. So, for example, if you want to shift it by a significant amount, you need the PMOS to be something like 10 times the size of the NMOS and so on. Okay, it is possible. There are situations in which you actually build inverters that way. Right? Now, what usually happens in practice, as we'll see later, is very often the shifting the VN or shifting the noise margin is only part of the reason for changing WP by WN. A more important reason might be making it asymmetric from the point of view of delay. So you want something which will have a very fast write time, even if it has a sort of slower fall time. Okay? Why is that? Because you want to be able to capture all kinds of writing events very quickly. Whereas falling events, you know that they are not, they are going to happen obviously equally often, but they are not the important events that you need to get triggered. Okay. So there can be situations in which you are concerned with having a fast rising delay and a long falling delay, or the other way around. In such a situation also you can change WP by WN and make the inverter asymmetric. Okay. So in other words, this WP by WN gives you a lot of control over the kind of behavior of the inverter that you can see. Now whether you want to do all that or not depends on your application. Okay? Alright. So now what we have done is we have seen an example of how we can estimate the VN value. Right? Before we go further, let's quickly see what would happen if the transistors were in velocity saturation instead of saturation. What would have happened in that case? The same this equation must still hold, right? But now the difference is mu n C of WP by LP VD sat n written down the exact equations as before, replacing VD sat as V min, okay, instead of VDS minus VDD. This left hand side should be WN by L. Okay? Once again, what we can do in this case is define ratio R is equal to, but now into VD sat N, or rather VD sat T, by and with this expression, once again play around with the thing, you will approximately get R by 1 plus R into VVD. Something similar is what you will get again, right? In this case, there is also a VD sat on the right hand side. Okay, so actually, if you want, you can go through the calculation. It becomes a little bit more messy than it was before, but you will end up with something fairly similar. Okay, R by 1 plus R, R is not square root of Wp by Lp by Wn by Ln into mu n by mu p anymore. Right? In this case, it is mu p Wp by Lp Vd sat t divided by mu n Wn by Ln Vd sat n. So the Vd sat also becomes a parameter which comes into play over here. Right? And that is yet another thing that you need to sort of keep equal. The same condition holds. You still want R equal to 1 for Vm equal to Vd by 2. But for that now, the exact ratio Wp by Wn, what should it be? Not just mu n by mu p. You also have the Vd sat n and Vd sat p terms to take care of. Right? That's the only difference that really comes in over here. Okay. Now, it is possible that in practice, when you are trying to do these computations, based on the numbers, based on Vd sat n, Vd sat p and various other things, you find that the actual point of operation is such that maybe the nMOS is velocity saturated, but the pMOS is only regular saturation. Okay. How do you find all that out? The general way of solving such things, supposing I just give you the parameters Wp, Wn and so on for a given set of transistors and inverters and ask you to do these calculations, what ultimately ends up happening is that you need to do the calculation assuming something. Assume that the nMOS is velocity saturated, assume that the pMOS is regular saturation, whatever you want. Do the computation by putting in the correct equation. After that, you will finally get values for VGS and VDS for all of the transistors. Plug those back in and check whether your assumptions that you started with were correct. Okay? So for doing hand calculations, this process can sometimes be iterative. You make an assumption, you do the entire computation, you find that your assumption was wrong. Okay? You need to go back and fix it. There will always be some converging point, some point under which the conditions are all satisfied and you get the correct answer. Right? Because all of these equations themselves are continuous. But other than that, you may sometimes have to make an assumption, do the calculation, check and find that it was wrong and recorrect for it. Okay? So that's something to keep in mind when you're actually doing any hand computation. In practice, in general, what you will do is do the hand computation so that you get a quick, rough estimate. For example, this hand calculation that we did over here tells us a lot of useful information. Right? What is this R and how should it be determined and what should the ratio Wn by Wp be? All of those things come out intuitively because of the hand calculation that we did. If you had just run simulation, you wouldn't have got any of that feel for what is happening out here. Okay? So that's the reason for doing the hand calculation. At the end of the day, if you want to do an accurate estimate, then you have to do a full simulation and get the numbers from there. Okay? Alright, we'll stop here for now. The next thing that we are going to do, okay, so on this Friday's class, we are going to have a session in 301. Okay, so the session will be in ESD 301. We'll be posting an update on Moodle. By the way, does everyone here have access to the Moodle? Anyone who is not able to log into the Moodle site, right? Huh? You are an M.Tech student or? It should be listed. So please check with the computer center why that is not happening, right? So please make sure by Friday or so that all of you have access to the Moodle. Right, if not, then let me know. Send me an email or something like that. I'll try to get it fixed. But first, contact the computer center and see whether you can get it fixed. If that's not working, then you can tell me and I'll try to add you separately to the Moodle. We'll be posting the assignment questions as well as material for the course on the Moodle. So please make sure that you have access to it and check it regularly. Okay? The class will be in ESB 301. That's on the top floor, all the way at the other end of the building. Okay? And during that session, the TAs will be giving you a demonstration of how to use files and the layout tool Magic, and we'll be giving you the assignments that you need to do for